Namaste and good morning, everyone. A warm welcome to all of you to the 10th session in the webinar series on the theme Each for Equal, Promoting Women in STEM, being organized by Vigyan Prasad. In today's session, we will learn about setting priorities in health research, clinical practice, and related policy making. In healthcare research, as in every other domain, professional, material, and financial resources are always limited. Therefore, the focus must be on really important issues and activities that have added value for human and societal well-being. Accordingly, priority setting is a matter of daily concern in healthcare and policymaking. Today, we are delighted to have with us an acclaimed clinical practitioner, Dr. Shinjani Bhatnagar, Professor of Eminence, Translational Health Science and Technology Institute, Faridabad, to introduce us to this prioritization process in healthcare. We extend a warm and heartfelt welcome to you, ma'am. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation. We also have with us our director, Dr. Nakul Parashar from Vigyan Prasad, who have been guiding us throughout in all our endeavors. We welcome you, sir. Thank you for coming. We also welcome the large group of women scientists, researchers, science teachers, students, and all other people attending this webinar through YouTube and Facebook handles of ISTI portal and Vigyan Prasad, where it being broadcasted live. For setting the context of the webinar, we have with us Dr. Kinkini Das Gupta Mishra, Senior Scientist at Gender and Technology Communication Program of Vigyan Prasad. She has been the trendsetter in the whole process of conducting this webinar series. Now, to begin with, I would like to invite our director, Dr. Nakul Parashar, sir, for his opening remarks. Over to you, sir.
Namaskar and a very warm, I would still say still morning, so very good morning to one and all. And on behalf of Vigyan Prasad, the entire team that has been organizing this series of lectures, I would like to thank them. And also I would like to thank Dr. Shinjani Bhatnagarji for having accepted our invitation for this lecture today. We've all been aware. We are aware of the work that is being done by the institute in Faridabad, where Dr. Bhatnagar comes from. She's been a professor of eminence. She's been a scientist of eminence, and it's indeed a pleasure for us to have you, ma'am, with us in today's lecture. Out here, we've been talking about a lot about gender in the past, and there's a lot that we see has happened in the last 7-8 years, and but there's still a lot to be done. And in order to do so, I guess we'll all have to come forward. We'll have to, you know, empower all those agencies that are building up these resources, particularly in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. It's very important for us to ensure that our women scientists do get their share and feel empowered and encouraged enough to take up things at much, much bigger levels. Over a period of time, we have seen how things have changed. But we've also seen how, we've also noticed how COVID-19 has played an important role in shaping up a new normal that we call. Even if we return to our normal, there will be a lot of things that have not been there in the past will get, will find a place in our new setups. And for that matter, I guess it's time that we all realize how important it is for all of us to ensure, support, and encourage women folk to come forward and take the responsibility and own the mantle of leading science and technology in the country. I know there's a lot that I can go on and on to speak on this particular topic, and you feel very encouraged and you feel very happy to, you know, see the figures, statistics over a period of last few years, rising up and up. So without taking much of your time and not stepping between Professor Shinjani Bhatnagar she is today. And really want to once again thank Professor Bhatnagar for accepting our request to deliver today's address. Thank you so much, ma'am, and we welcome you wholeheartedly, and we also expect your continued patronage support to Vigyan Prasar in its endeavor, particularly where we are trying to bring up a lot of things with regards to, I'm looking for a brochure that was kept here, where we are trying to bring a coffee table book on 75 scientists in the country. And so there'll be much more, I guess, where we will certainly seek your support, your participation in our endeavors, particularly towards the gender that we talk about. Thank you once again. And I'm sure we'll have a very nice and a very enthralling lecture from your side. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir, for your motivation and supporting words. Now, before I invite Kinkini ma'am for throwing light upon the concerns of today's webinar, I would like to remind all the participants that if you have any queries, suggestions, or doubt regarding the session, you can interact directly with the speaker by posting them in the comment section using the hashtag #EachForEqual, or you can raise your hand and we will interact with the speaker directly in the open discussion session. Now I invite ma'am to please proceed the session. Over to you, Kinkini ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Nidhi. I mentioned that the COVID scenario has changed the whole perspective of health research. So in the current COVID scenario, setting priorities for health research is essential to maximize the impact of investments, which is especially relevant in greater demand and resource poor environments. So health research prioritization is regarded as a key part of efforts needed to strengthen national health research systems. And prioritization is necessary to facilitate the current demand for increased harmonization of health research at a global level, at the national level, particularly in combination with the evolving new and risky diseases, and analyze the flow of health research. And as ma'am has been engaged with extensive research, health research priority setting processes assist researchers and policymakers in effectively targeting research that has the greatest potential towards public health benefit. And many different approaches to health research prioritization exist. But there is no agreement on what might constitute the best practices. Therefore, taking the heterogeneous nature of research priority setting exercises into account, while recognizing the need for agreement and appropriate guidance for these exercises, we need to think on what defines a good practice for health research and clinical research prioritization process. And the policy related to health is also required for planning high quality health research priority setting exercise at the national level and also at the local level. So, but what goes into the process of setting the priorities? Who are the stakeholders and what else needs to be done for supporting this ecosystem? Who would be better to learn from about this than from the professional who has been working in this field? And the one who also represents and embodies women in clinical research practice and leadership, Dr. Shinjini Bhatnagar, Professor of Eminence and former Dean Clinical Research and Head Pediatric Biology Center of THISTI, Translational Health Science and Technology Institute, which is an organization, autonomous organization of Department of Biotechnology, located in, situated at Faridabad. A warm welcome to you, ma'am. With this webinar series on Each for Equal, promoting women in STEM, as Sir has already mentioned, we bring together on platform women researchers, scientists, by providing our audience an opportunity to see the research world through their eyes and interact directly with them. And they're the role models for future generations inspired and committed to the most competitive fields of research. And these distinguished scientists illustrate the remarkable contributions that women can bring to science. With this, we at Vigyan Prasar, a national level science communication, popularization, and extension organization of the Department of Science and Technology, making an attempt to sensitize the young scholars, particularly girls and college students, about cutting edge research and motivate them to take up research careers. Dear audience, our esteemed guest for today is Dr. Shindini Patnagar. She is a physician scientist who worked with the Department of Pediatrics AIIMS for 25 years of pediatric gastroenterologist and a research scientist. The main significant contribution which I would like to mention here is that her group hypothesis-driven research led to the introduction of modified low osmolarity ORS and zinc in treatment of childhood diarrhea and diagnostic test for celiac diseases. She was Dean Clinical Research for 6 years and currently the Professor of Eminence at THISTI. And she now leads large interdisciplinary research studies that bridge classical clinical research and modern biology to find solutions for diseases with public health importance. She's leading Garbhini, an interdisciplinary group for advanced research on birth outcome, which is a DBT India initiative, and some large randomized controlled trials to evaluate interventions for reducing early life morbidity. I would like to also mention that she is a fellow of 3 national academies, FAMS, NAMS, and INSA. Thank you so much for accepting our invitation here, ma'am. I now invite you for your talk. Over to you, ma'am.
I'm really humbled by the fact that you thought I should come speak today. And I had encouraged a lot of young women scientists who are working in THSTI to also join, just to understand what an important initiative you people are leading and taking forward. And believe me, when we started our career, I would say after doing my MBBS, which was like 1984, I think some of them would have been not there or just born or whatever. Women scientists, women researchers, physician scientists were not really heard of. I'm talking about more the physician scientists and of course also a lot of other scientists taking a lead role in many research activities. So thank you so much. Thank you for your kind words. And actually, I'm more humbled by the fact that you asked me to come and speak here. I have put together what has shaped my life as a woman scientist, as a physician scientist, what has made a difference, and how we moved forward with the various challenges. I would request a screen sharing so that I can start my presentation. Yes. I would request the young scientists who are here to ask questions later on, fearlessly, because that's the whole platform about.
You have been made the co-host, so you can present your screen.
Have you been able to... there, ma'am.
Ah, it's okay. Bye.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So as I've called it from research to clinical practice and policy, identifying priorities early, and the emphasis is on identifying priorities early, because really very early in life is when you start to decide how you want to take your life forward. And so fortunately for me and for many others who are in the group here, as well as other members of the group, were able to do this quickly enough. Thank you. So, Pinush, I request you to move them up.
Yeah.
Because I can't see the slides that can keep it.
Sure.
Science and technology, as we all know, is the key interpretation of the complexity of our lives. So So what does it comprise of? Significant discovery, which many of you in the group could be involved with. But this discovery has to go into transformative, impactful innovations. And there has to be, at the end of the day, this research going into policy. Going to people who really need it. Going to people who, I want to see the full screen, Piyush.
No, ma'am. Ma'am, unko dikhne
di thi. Sorry, I'm so sorry about this. So, whatever research we are doing, eventually what it needs is to go to the people either in the practice or in policy. And that's where the important challenges come. So, if we look at what are we doing, are we asking the right research questions? Are we unearthing solutions to complex human problems? So this is something that all of us who are in research are thinking about or should be thinking about. The right research questions. Are we unearthing solutions to complex human problems? And should we really be thinking more about the translational value of our work? Translational meaning, is this work going to the people who it needs to go to the stakeholders, to the clinic, to the patients, to the population? Is it getting there? Or is it remaining on the bench, contributing to great discovery work? Or do we want to move beyond that and actually give it to these people? Are we working, and another very important question, are we working in isolation? So whatever I'm going to present to you is not what I've done alone. It's as a group. Earlier, as a group at the Orinda Institute of Medical Sciences, where I began my life as a physician way back after MBBS in 1984, and then moved on to become a physician scientist there, and then now at THSTI, where I have a group of young scientists working with me. And you all be, at least all the women scientists in the audience would be happy to know that I think our proportion is 3:1. We are a large number of women scientists working together, and that's great. So as seniors now, the environment, so as seniors now, the responsibility of some of the leaders who are already there in the audience and who are leading groups, the environment in which we ask our research questions will influence our behavior and productivity. And that environment, or that providing that environment, becomes the responsibility of the leaders, of the PIs, of the, you know, the senior members of the research groups. But recognizing the path that you want to move on, you want to take forward, is your responsibility. Of course, augmented hugely by the people around you. And that path is what you need to identify. That gives you focus, that gives you clarity on how to shape your career. So there's a very interesting quote in this article, Science 2006, if you're vague about what you want, chances are that you won't get it. And therefore, you need to know your career goals early enough, or at least somewhat clarity should be there. But the more important thing is you should be hungry to grow, hungry to improve. Unless you have that hunger, you're not going to move forward in the career that you have chosen. And how do you do that? Be curious, be bold, be receptive, be honest, and above all, respect time. Respect time that you have to do it quickly enough for it to become important. Now, for me, are these words or do they really mean something? And actually, these have come out of the way our lives spanned over the last 3.5 decades, as I said, first at Arlington Institute of Medical Sciences. I was very lucky and fortunate, and many of us in the group that's been with me here present with, you know, I ask them to be here while I present because I'm not presenting my work alone, I'm presenting work from many of us. And many of my other colleagues at AIMS, we were very fortunate to get a mentor who paved this, who gave us that environment, and we chose the path to become physician scientists. And the most important question for us was, be curious. Ask novel questions. Do not believe that the question that somebody else has asked is enough for you to answer. It may be, but the difference you'll make is by asking novel questions. Step out of your comfort zone. Ask thought-provoking questions. And we asked those questions that were different because we were taught to be outliers. We developed into physician scientists. So while I saw patients at AIMS, I was also doing research. And that at that time was a rarity. And bringing in the woman angle, I got into research. And a lot of people at that time thought I got into research because I get more time as I'm a woman to look after my family. And that was something which we challenged and we were able to move forward. And this group that Professor N.K. Mahan set up at AIMS was actually, again, largely women scientists. And our main important thing was that we participated in research that provided evidence for policy. And the other important thing before I actually come to the work we did was that when you're getting into research, be bold to explore things that scare you. Obviously, if you're being an outlier and you're not doing things that you're comfortable with, you're going to be scared. We were scared. We're physicians. We like seeing patients. Can we see something beyond that? There are some members in my group who came in as pure biologists, but are now working on the clinical side of research. Were they scared? Yes, of course they were scared. But then you have to be bold to explore things that scare you. Learn as much as you can about them until they no longer scare you. And the best way of doing that is talk through challenges so that they can convert that fear into excitement. And that is where, you know, the excitement of research comes in. That you have to be challenged enough, motivated enough to be excited. The scare will go, the fear will go. And therefore, that environment, that excitement took us through large hospital and population-based intervention studies and observational cohorts to study complex diseases. And most of us are, so what did we do? Our discovery was inspired for an application, but that inspiration came from the need of a society. So if you are doing something, the need of the society becomes paramount. So inspired discovery along with innovation, we're developing an application which, inspired by the need of the society, is going back into the society and providing a benefit to the society, a human, a public good. And that is what all our research has been about. So our first thing was, I don't know, you know, when we were in 1980s, even now, the thing that scared us were those malnourished children. You know, we went into the fields and saw these really malnourished children with persistent diarrhea, with no treatment. So our first area that we worked in was in persistent diarrhea. We did large randomized controlled studies and proved that you don't need antimicrobials for persistent diarrhea. What you need is an evidence-based dietary algorithm to be able to treat it. And this algorithm was tested in many developing countries. It was an algorithm that was tested within India. We didn't extrapolate Western data. We tested it in many developing countries, adapted it for global use, and today it's included in the national guidelines and it's part of all the medical pediatric textbooks and training. I don't know if I told you, but I'm a pediatrician by training. So this department that we were working with, our mentor was a pediatrician, and we were at the Department of Pediatrics at all of the Institute of Medical Sciences. So the next thing, obviously, as a pediatrician, we worry about the viral diseases and the mortality and the morbidity associated with it. So we conducted, so there were lab studies which showed, so here you can see a beautiful transition from the lab to clinical studies to introduction into a national guideline. Intestinal perfusion studies and experimental models and adult human volunteers showed that if you decrease the osmolarity of the ORS, which was currently available that time, will decrease dilatation because the osmotic load will be less. So we followed it up to prove what was seen in the lab. We followed it up with large, many, many thousands of children studies, double-blind, placebo-controlled clinical trials in children and adults, found that a low osmolarity ORS works in diarrheal diseases. And today, the ORS, which is available in the market as Electral or whatever other company is producing it, is this low osmolarity ORS, which is again in the national and the global diarrheal treatment program of the country as well as from WHO. And the interesting thing here was that after providing evidence, we had to go to the government and tell them, look, this is it. This is changing the diarrheal picture. That is what the evidence is, what convinced the government to change the policy, and evidence is what convinced the industry to change the formulation of something which they've been using for years into the low osmolarity ORS. And you know, an interesting thing, I show this slide very often, is that as physicians, in the Department of Pediatrics at AIMS, where we were actually collecting, every stool was collected because our outcome was stool weight. And that was our experiment. We were collecting it with so much precision, you know, with condom drainage, with diapers, which were pre-weighed, because we had to have a very objective outcome parameter. In fact, we were so obsessed with this experiment, with this trial that we were doing and collecting the stool, that we were called the shitty gang by the other physicians who were in pediatrics there. So again, based on this, this is now considered the universal ORS for all ages and types of diarrhea. Until today, it continues to be the universal ORS. And then we decided that could we add something more to the ORS to improve the management of diarrhea? And therefore, again, there were human volunteer studies. We found in lab that the zinc influences host immune responses and epithelial repair, went on to do cohort studies, large RCT, established the efficacy of zinc in reducing diarrhea duration and severity. And today, again, zinc and ORS is in the national and global policy based on the work that was done in the small little department. You know, pediatric gastroenterology was a small department in a large department of pediatrics. This ORS room, this room where we did all this, was not larger than, I don't know, not larger than an office area. And yet, all of this came out from there because we believed that this could happen. And of course, we had our leader who believed that this could happen. And again, we were able to transfer the technology for making just zinc alone tablets to the industry, because till then, as you know, zinc was coming as a micronutrient, as a composite micronutrient tablet and not zinc alone. Then, of course, when we went on to establish comprehensively that giving zinc separately from ORS is a more powerful public health intervention rather than mixing it with ORS. Our next then step was, so again, these were questions we were asking. It wasn't as if we were just randomly doing this. It was one question leading into another question. Can zinc supplementation be used to treat other child infections? And we started looking at pneumonia and sepsis. And we found that zinc is effective in treatment of clinical sepsis, young infants who are coming with bad bacterial infection. It gives zinc in addition to antibiotics. It decreases treatment failure rate. And this we were able to publish in Lancet in 2012. But now, currently, we're taking this question further. It's taking a story to its logical conclusion. We're seeing, does zinc also reduce mortality in addition to reducing treatment failure when given in clinical sepsis? So then we're trying to see if it's reproducible, if it is more effective. And once we have this larger evidence, we can go to the government and say, this is a simple, cheap tablet of zinc can be given as a policy in young infants. India Rotavax story, all of you know, Professor Khan was responsible for the current Rotavax vaccine, which is available in the market. And I was not directly involved with it, but was part of the larger group that took the story from beginning to the end. And you all know now it's part of the national immunization program. So what did we learn? See the big picture. Don't get into these small things in life. You have to see the larger picture. Walk till the end of the story. Finish the story that you're starting. Don't depend on government funding alone. You have to look at global funding. For that, you have to be hugely competitive, both for government funding as well as for international funding. And learn team science. And that's what brought me to the next phase of my life. The challenges of connectivity. If we want to do so, discovery, remember, require individuals, small groups. But when you get into translational research, so what we did was large, was a small group, but we were connecting with a lot of groups. But when you want to do translational research, if you want to get into big time translational research, you need teams. You need to connect with, as I've shown here, many groups. And that's what in 2010, when I moved to THSTI as a founder faculty, again, the whole mandate was what we had been doing in that small room at All India Institute of Medical Sciences in a larger institution. And that's what motivated me to come here. And I'm not going into the details, but I will talk more about the maternal child health program that we had THSTI and what we've done there. One of the things that we were able to do is a continuous story from AIIMS was develop a diagnostic test for celiac disease. And the reason why we did it, because when we used to sit in the OPD, we realized that our children who were coming there couldn't afford the diagnostic tests which were available in the market. So with the CELAC bank that we had of our patients with celiac disease, we connected with Dr. Naveen Khanna at ICGEB and with Jay Mitra, and were able to develop this celiac card and this point of care test and an ELISA today, which is now again commercialized and being used by patients in the market. But the big program that the director very kindly spoke about was, is Garbhini. And the reason why we got into Garbhini was, again, not something that we were pushed into. It was a question that was being asked. Preterm birth is a major killer in our country. And there are many unresolved questions around it because there are deep gaps in biological knowledge, deep gaps in its clinical severity, deep gaps in understanding this whole syndrome of multiple etiologies. And so we started this big program, which is called Garbhini, and basically with a hypothesis that pregnancy is a dynamic condition, it has clinical and epi and biological modulation at different stages of pregnancy, and therefore time series data collected across pregnancy would help us to identify these women early so that they can be referred early for better management. What is happening just now is they're coming to hospitals and the delivery is happening. Once the preterm baby is born, then you have to look after that baby and their challenges. Financial challenges, medical challenges, and therefore we need to identify these women. And that is where we came into this, again, a concept that we have epidemiology and multi-omics analysis, which will lead into a risk factor identification and eventually an algorithm which will help us to identify these women. But along with this multi-omics analysis for biomarker identification, we can also understand the biology and mechanistic inference to find candidate interventions, which can then be used for identification, which can be then tested in large randomized controlled studies for preterm birth. So I want to show you this, that here it was not an individual asking a question. The question is being asked, which is novel. It is required by the society, and there's a lot of team science. It's clinical, epidemiology, ultrasound-based imaging, multi-omics, biology, and in the end, we have to do candidate interventions, clinical people who have expert medical trials. So the idea was to get together a group which was multidisciplinary. Again, this is being done at a district hospital in Gurgaon. We have hospitals and national research institutes in partnership being coordinated by THSTI to do this program. It is very truly interdisciplinary. We are following a pregnancy cohort. We calculated a sample size of 8,000. We've already enrolled more than 8,000 women who are followed from early pregnancy up till one delivery and one visit after delivery. Very accurate phenotyping is being done by collecting all the clinical data, their various biospecimens, and ultrasound imaging across pregnancy. This is the first pregnancy cohort in the country where such systematic analysis of pregnancy and adverse pregnancy outcomes is being done at such a large scale. This is what I talked about, developing dynamic personalized risk prediction model. So it's not just us biologists and clinical people working. We've also got data science people on board who are helping us to develop this prediction algorithm. And as you can see, as we move forward, more and more risk factors are being added to get a model which will be hugely effective and translated into clinical practice. So then the multi-omics analysis that we've done in partnership with our biologists is we've looked at the genetic predictors of preterm birth, we've looked at antenatal epigenomic alterations, are they associated with preterm birth and have some interesting results. We have protein-based biomarkers that we are looking at across pregnancy and term versus preterm, and microbes. We are doing hypervaginal microbe biome analysis to see, and we found that the vaginal microbiome of a term versus preterm is different. And could that be used as a biomarker, as well as could it be developed into an intervention later for preventing preterm birth? We've got interesting tools emerging from the ultrasound-based markers we're doing, which is dating models, video sweeps, which are helping us to develop a computer-assisted low-cost point-of-care ultrasound, and automation of measurement of fetal anthropometry in antenatal ultrasound, so that if it's being done in small hospitals, less time and less expertise is required for doing this. And that again would be a huge translation. So as you can see, from a cohort, from this interdisciplinary nature, there are so many outcomes that we'll be able to get. And in this whole thing, there are a lot of young scientists that are involved from different disciplines. So you don't need just a clinician to find a solution for preterm birth or for anything. Nor do you need just a biologist for finding a drug or an intervention. It has to be deep science. And just this, I want to say this is very important, that again, our involvement of data scientists. I'm sorry, you know, I had a slide about, which seems to have got missed, is about the Pew biorepository that we have created, which is multiple biospecimens which have come from these various mothers that have been enrolled, as well as the babies and placenta samples. So what we've started with that is a program around the biology of placenta. So can you imagine, can you understand the biology of placenta if you do not know what the mother is all, what the pregnancy is all about? It's not possible. And that is where you need interdisciplinary sciences and you need to coordinate. And fortunately, and because we were, just to say that it's not just the national, we've of course one of the biggest cohorts, and I'm not blowing the trumpet, I'm just saying that it's a lot of effort, a lot of challenges, but we've achieved something, a small little bit. But we've also been able to partner with a lot of international cohorts, harmonize our data, and today we are in a position, because of harmonized data, 26,000 mother infant dyads will eventually be analyzed for omics, omic biomarkers for preterm birth. So it's not, again, just your little world. It's the world about the disease that you are studying. It's about the patient that you want to contribute to. You're actually serving your patient through the good science that you're doing. And that is what is important. Okay, my last two, three slides. I'm sorry that I have exceeded time, but so since we were already into this large cohort and we have an interdisciplinary team, I'm sorry I'm not taking names of all these scientists. Largely, many of them are women scientists who have led this. We have some very good male scientists who I think sometimes feel a little left out because there's so many women in the group. But we make an, you know, it's an interesting group that we have, because we already had these cohorts going during COVID last year. We were able to set up these very quickly, two more cohorts, an adult cohort from hospitals in our partnership with hospitals, of COVID positive patients to study immune responses, to study what is happening to them long term, to study the host responses, both cellular and humoral, and develop from them COVID bioresources. Today at THSTI, at the cluster, we have one of the biggest COVID-19 bioresources, over 5,000 samples of patients with COVID and different stages of their disease. And we have another pregnancy cohort, which we have set up within Galvani. And very recently, this year, we've started pediatric cohorts, COVID cohorts. As you all know, everybody is very concerned. What's going to happen to these children who have not been vaccinated, to look at risk factors of severe COVID? So again, the questions were novel. The questions were timely. That's why I said respect time. You have to get into that area at the right time. You can be doing something which is great science, but if it's not making relevance to the time you're living in, it may not mean anything. And so, this is being done with a lot of collaborators from hospitals. Can you do it, Piyush, please?
Yeah.
It's not moving. Yeah. And so, again, one more, please. Again, there are these, again, our partners, one more, yeah. Partners across hospitals, as we said, the biologists, the immunologists came, epidemiologists came from THSTI, but we have collaboration with our hospital. And that bioresource today has been able to provide, as you can see here, so many positive samples. We have samples at different time points, we have CLA panels, and we've been able to provide to many industry partners who wanted to develop diagnostics, who are working on vaccines, on researchers who are doing COVID-related research because of this national resource. So my last two slides, I want to read with what has been the lesson for life for me. Firstly, I know it's important for us as women to speak our minds. But I don't think we should put the woman card on the face of things. you know, it's, we are women and we can do it. I mean, I don't see why we should be different, right? So using a woman card to say we are women scientists is good, but it's only to say that why are you making so much discrimination? We are as good, if not better, sorry, but certainly as good. And, you know, I was taught this by my mentor, who was not a woman, was a man who respected women, who respected that we are as good or as bad as any other male scientist or physician or doctor that he had in his team. He told us, you know, don't worry about designations. Never worry about designations, never worry about positions. Nobody's going to remember you. Unfortunately, we lost him last year in January. And today, I think people may remember him as Professor of Pediatrics AIMS, may remember him as Deputy Secretary to Government of India, but mostly he's remembered for the work he's done. Mostly he's remembered for the large number of interventions and policy differences he's made. Because he said, be an outlier. Don't sit in your comfort zone all the time. And whatever area you choose, whether it's discovery research, whether it's clinical trial, whether you're a translational researcher, try to be an outlier. And never be complacent about your success. You know, the minute you think you've achieved it all, that's the end of your work. You should always be anxious about your success. And I remember when I became the dean and I went to him and I said, I've become the dean. He said, so what? Nobody's going to remember you as the dean. And it's true. People just remember you for the work you do. And that's what matters. And next slide. And therefore, as I said, don't be a woman, because I think we are so many inherent qualities of multitasking, but have the power of being heard. Don't allow yourself not to be heard. That's the most important thing. Affect what you want to see change. That is the power you should have. And you should harness the power of collective collaboration. Never shy away from building bridges. If you burn them, then you're not going to. If you're going to sit in that little cocoon of yours, believing that your work is your work and the best, I don't think you're going to achieve very much. So thank you very much. I'm happy to answer questions. I'm sorry I've rushed through a lot of stuff, but it's about 35 years of my life, of our life that we've lived, reaching where we are today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your research with us on our platform and explaining it to our audience in such a simple voice, as well as you have motivating the large number of aspiring researchers out there who are listening to this session today. Thank you so much, ma'am. Now, moving towards the open discussion, first of all, I invite our live audience that if you have any queries, you can raise your hand and we will unmute you and you can ask the question directly to ma'am. Now to begin, I will ask the first question, which we have obtained from our live platform, that how does and how much research affect the clinical practice?
Sorry, just to say that again, that's your question.
Yeah, ma'am, it is from the live platform, from the Facebook page, that okay. How does and how much research affect the clinical practice?
I think it should affect, I think clinical practice should be evidence-based. And so, I don't know if you know this, I don't want to get into controversial issues here, but COVID has taught us a lot, right? A lot of interventions were used which had no clinical evidence, right? And a lot of interventions were not used which had clinical evidence. But if we are scientists, then clinical research should actually be the basis of clinical practice. And you know, there is, when we started our research way back, I don't think people understood what we were doing. Really, honestly, I think even my family didn't understand what we were doing. And, you know, I'm telling you, we were called the shitty doctors because they thought all we did was weigh the stools of these patients, of these little babies. But at the end of the day, we got a change of a practice. And ORS today is the cornerstone of therapy for childhood varicella. So it just has to be the basis of clinical practice.
Seriously, ma'am, wonderful work has been done by you and your team. Thank you so much. And the next question is, how one can come up with the risk factors faced in the trial of clinical research?
How one can come up with the risk factors
associated with in the trials of clinical research?
Okay, so I think you have to understand that a clinical trial is an intervention trial where, I don't know if I've understood the question right, they can correct me, but a clinical trial is actually evaluating an intervention and it helps you to develop a cause-effect relationship. We can look at, let's say, an example of Covishield or one of the vaccines, Covaxin. They were done in clinical trials to look at whether Covaxin is making a difference to the disease, right? And preventing disease. So the outcome was prevention of COVID-19. Now, when you want to look at risk factors of the intervention, you can look at it within the clinical trial as subgroup analyses, where you can say, okay, you can look at it in subgroups of age, of severity, of associated comorbidity. That's the way you can study risk factors in a clinical trial. Or you can study risk factors the way we are doing in a large analytical observational cohort where they're trying to understand the complex phenotype like C-tumble. So there you will take a cohort and you follow it up and you look at those who are exposed and those who are not exposed. So those who have the risk factor and those who don't have the risk factor, and study an association of the risk factor with the disease. Remember, observational cohort does not give you a cause-effect relationship. It only gives you an association. It's only an intervention trial that will help you to get a cause-effect relationship. I don't know if I've answered the question.
I think, ma'am, you have justified the question very much. Now, ma'am, the next question is, what are the common challenges of implementation of an evidence-based practice model in clinical practice?
A lot. So that's a very relevant question because a personal belief in clinical practice becomes very important. I remember when we used to treat diarrhea, and some of my colleagues in the audience were with us in the OPD and in the wards then, we didn't give antibiotics, right? And because the implementation of treatment of diarrhea is ORS and zinc, and yet there were these doctors who, because there's voluminous stool being passed, the mothers are getting anxious, the child is crying, but we were implementing an evidence-based algorithm for management of diarrhea. What happens is that very often personal belief overrides that, and therefore comes in the irrational use of antimicrobials, and that's why you're seeing so much antimicrobial resistance today. You know, ciprofloxacin, which is supposed to be given in dysentery, the only drug which can actually work in dysentery is not making any difference anymore. The other problem is that a lot of use of probiotics and other drugs, which could have been driven by other compulsions, which are not evidence-based. So clinical practice, personal clinical practice is very different from a policy, from a national guideline, from what you should be doing as evidence-based. there is, and I think bridging that is still a challenge. And COVID would have, there was so much use of steroids when there was a very defined indication for use of steroids in COVID, and yet it was used. So, you know, it's a challenging part. And I think we're not there really, that you're really using evidence for all clinical decisions.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And we can understand that you have other commitment and responsibilities too. So I request all the participants that if you have more queries, you can send it to our mail ID and we will forward it to ma'am, and ma'am will answer those questions. Ma'am, at the end, if you have any concluding remarks for our audience and the participants.
So I would be very happy if any of the scientists there would want to ask us more questions, want to visit THSTI when, of course, you know, things are a little more open, I guess, as things are improving, want to see what, you know, if they are who want to think in, on these lines and want to do this kind of work, our team here would be more than happy to have them visit us, interact with us, either in person or on emails, on Zoom, whatever they want. We'd be very happy because we really need more scientists who can work in this interface of wanting to provide discovery, which is, as I said, inspired by a society. Remember, at the end of the day, that I'm not, please don't get me wrong, I think discovery research, biology, fundamental research is very, very important. I'm just talking about a very different sphere, a different space, which is also as important and needs to be really encouraged. So that's it. All the best. I hope the young scientists there would shape their careers, identify their priorities early, whatever they are, and have a large vision, big vision. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. On your words, I want to share that Vigyan Prasar, we are publishing a COVID newsletter every fortnight. And we would love to have your research to get published in our newsletter. If you can share it with us, we will be privileged, ma'am. Now, coming to the end of the session, we would like to thank Dr. Shrinjini Bhatnagar, ma'am, once again for enlightening us with your valuable thoughts. Ma'am, your talk will surely motivate thousands and millions of young researchers out there. We feel extremely privileged to have you on our platform. Today, we conclude this session with the hope that the audience would try to follow your footprints and bring about a change in the society. We also hope that the goal and objective of this webinar series is moving closer to its fulfillment with every session that we are organizing. The recording of this webinar and all other webinars can be accessed through ISTI YouTube channel. For more information about the upcoming webinars of the India Networks in Science and Technology, kindly visit India Science Technology and Innovation Portal. Thank you everyone for your patience and hearing. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you everyone.